I hit the record button. That means we're recording. You guys actually get a show. This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 398. Guess who's back? I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, your host. And I know it's been a while. May was a really bad month, but I'm here and I'm back. And actually have some shows lined up, maybe even another one next week. And I'm happy to be here. I miss y'all, and I know some of you have been missing me, and so here I am. This is kind of a talking to myself show, but kind of not, because I do have a guest. And before I bring on my guest, I just wanted to say hello and thank you all for hanging in there. And been a while since I've been in the studio, and it is a mess, as you can see behind me. We've had some upgrades here. You can see I got a new sign, thanks to my daughter, Gwen, N6GMG. And I may do an extreme close-up in a little bit. I posted a picture of it in the Facebook group the other day. And I haven't really had a ton of time for amateur radio in the last month. We did a drill. And yeah, you did it too. And I did a drill with one of the hospitals, and that went really well. And I actually have some footage that I might try to chop together for a show. Did play with some radio driving around in my car, and I'm getting ready for field day. And I hope you're getting ready for field day too. It's going to be fun. We actually lost our regular location that we haven't been able to use for a couple years, but we're going to go somewhere more exciting and more challenging too, and you'll have some video from that for sure. So before I keep rambling on, do you see there's people in the room? That's awesome. I'm going to introduce my guest. Oh, actually, I should introduce me first. I already did. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, your new host, and we're missing Gary. So hi, Gary. I bet Gary will watch us later on. I'm hoping to have you back in 2 episodes, but I may call you about the next episode because you might be interested in my guest and talking to her as well. Anyhow, without further ado, I will... Oh, it's not Richard Bateman. I will introduce you to my guest.
Hello.
Hi, guest.
Hi. I'm Gwen Goldenberg, N6GMG, and his daughter.
You're my daughter.
Yes.
Have you been on the show before?
Maybe just a visit, but like not actually like in a show.
Excellent. Well, it's great to have you here. Actually, a couple of our followers have asked us, you got to get a sidekick. Me and Gary worked well together, so I'm trying out sidekicks, and this is going to be the first one. And you will note, she's taller than I am. That's in real life.
Yeah, shorty.
That's in real life, too. And she's a real ham, and I'm a real ham, well, mostly. And tonight's episode is a thanks, I'm back. And since I've had some challenges and some guests that said they'd come and then they got sick, I still have one kind of on the line when he gets out of the hospital. I had another one or two that just are too busy. I thought I'd just do a talking to myself show. I thought I would talk to you all about how I got here and why I'm doing this. And yeah. And I will do that. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how I got here. So again, I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, formerly Kilo...
KJ6MCQ. Yeah,
Kilo Juliet 6, Mike Charlie Quebec. That was my original call sign as it was issued in 2011 when I first got licensed as a technician. And why did I do that? Well, I first got licensed because of her. And actually, the reason I ended up getting my ham license is before that I took a cert class. I was a volunteer at my kids' elementary school. I was on the PTA board, and we called it, what do we call it?
PAT.
Parents and Teachers Together. But most of you will know it as a PTA, you know, the parent board that works with the teachers and does all the fundraising and stuff. And I was involved in that for quite a long time. And at some point along the way, the school management decided we needed to have emergency preparedness. And we actually reached out to Los Angeles City Fire Department and brought in a cert class. And they came and did a cert class over 4 hours a night to do the 16 hours. And I actually had to miss one of those classes. And if I hadn't missed that one day, probably wouldn't be sitting here. So you had to do the four, but they let you do makeup. So I did three of the four, and I didn't get to graduate with the class. And then about 3 or 4 months later, they held another one at the local fire department. And I actually just signed up and did the whole course over again. And one of my friends, Paul Shively, who's very involved with CERT, or used to be very involved with CERT, sponsored the class, and we did the class. And at the end, there were a couple of guys that came to visit to talk to us about other stuff you could do beyond just, you know, being good neighborhood citizens and helping, you know, your neighborhood be prepared and checking on everybody after there's a disaster. And they were amateur radio operators. And one of them was Jack, KO6V. And I don't remember, the other one might have been Dan Tomlinson. Dan Tomlinson, who's NR6V. I don't remember what his call sign was back then. But anyways, they came and they talked to us. And I thought to myself, well, that's interesting. And I actually had some interest in being a ham years and years and years ago. But I had a hard time figuring out the code. And they said, you don't need code anymore. So wasn't long after that, I found a place I could take a test. And a one-day class. And that was at the...
where?
That was Lost Hills Sheriff's Department. And every quarter there's a great couple, and probably my first Elmers, Norm and Naomi Goodkin, who is K6YXH and WA6OHV. WA6OHW. Yeah, OHW. And they were kind of my first Elmers. We showed up that day. I took the test. I passed. And I became a ham. And at the end of the class, well, we were waiting to get our grade, our tests graded, and to see who passed and who didn't pass. Some of the local volunteer organizations came and talked to us about, you know, now that you have your license, what could you do? And the first gentleman who talked to us was one of the representatives of the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department Disaster Communication Service, DCS. And he started in with, now that you're licensed, you can come join us. And there's lots to do, and you have to put in like 48 hours every year, and you have to buy a uniform, and you have to follow all these standards, and you have to get all this training, and you go along and do all these different activities for the sheriff's department, but there's lots of time and lots of training and lots of uniforms and all this other stuff. And I thought, oh, okay, that sounds interesting, and I, you know, like to help the community, and that's all good. And then the next gentleman spoke. And the next gentleman was Chris Seitz, WA6VHA. And Chris got up and he said, there's another group too, and it's called ARES, Amateur Radio Emergency Service. And we don't have uniforms, and we don't have any minimum numbers of hours, and we do training every month, and you can come and go as you please. And guess what? That was a group I signed up with pretty much on the spot. By the time... that meeting was over and I got my my confirmation that I had a license. I went to Chris, I had a card, and within a couple weeks, the first Saturday of the month, I was at their meeting, I was signed up, and I was a member. And never looked back. That was a great group. It was a lot of fun. And Gwen, you've done a number of activities with, yes, the ARES group. In fact, you're now a member. Now that, mm-hmm, you have your call sign and you're a licensed technician, right?
Yeah, I've had my ticket for... a little bit more than a year now.
A little bit more. Almost 2.
Gone to lots of events. And
yeah. It's kind of fun, right?
Yeah.
And they all treat you like a ham now, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Yep. So I joined ARES, and wasn't too long after that I guess they took notice of me, and I was volunteering and doing stuff, and we did the statewide hospital drill, and shortly after that, I got an appointment to... AEC, Assistant Emergency Coordinator. And then I got assigned to hospital or assisting in a hospital. And that was lots of fun. And I did stuff with them like this. Let me show you some stuff. It's from my friend Bernard's website. This is let's take the titles and stuff away. You don't need to see that. This is from June 2012, Field Day. And some people you know here, some people I know here. So let's see. I'll introduce you to some of these folks. Hello. Of course, it's not going to work when I want it to. Let's see, refresh the page. Come on, people. Bernard's probably watching and disabled it. No, I'm just kidding. Let's see. That is so weird. Let's see. Let me reload the page. All right, let's do this. Let's kill that page, and we'll go back to June 2012. Here we go. One more time. Or maybe this one's not. Maybe this one doesn't have thumbnails. Well, anyway, in here, you can see there's me on the microphone, and I'm pretty sure that's Jack. And lots of happy, friendly faces. Some that are still around, and some that aren't still around. That you see in the group. And we had a nice barbecue. You can see the pictures at the end. And then the next year, here's my poster child. We got up front and personal. That's me and Gwen. I think these we can click into.
Yeah, I think so.
Oh yeah, here we go. So that's by then I had upgraded to general, and I got my current call sign and got an appointment to emergency coordinator, and that's my friend Dean, WA6P. He's an assistant DEC, and there we're operating field day, and that's Ruzy. He's our DEC, district emergency coordinator, Ruzy, and that's the back of my truck. And we set up a kind of a demo there, and actually made it onto the TV news. That was pretty cool. And there's Ruzy, and there's Clara, KJ6CNO, and AR6TX. I don't really know him. And there's Gwen. That's Gwen. What year was that? 2013. So that was like 5 years ago. You were Shorty. Let's bring you up on a couple other highlights. My friend Bernard loves to take these pictures, and he's really great at it. He can really get the smiles going, that's for sure. Bernard is KG6FBM. This is his website. And Gwen got to operate field day that year and kind of hooked her. She that was her first field day, and she spent that whole weekend, I think, with us. I think 36 or more hours there.
Yep.
And usually we start Friday night. We do the Friday night setup, and she stayed the whole time. And even when I wanted to go home and take a shower, she complained about it, but we did and came back. There's me reading the manual, and there's Chris Seitz. He's the one that talked to us at that first meeting and talked me into coming to join Aries. And there's our generator setup. And there's Bernard. Bernard loves to do this.
Nice.
Fun camera tricks. So Gwen's holding up the moon there. And there too. And there's Terry, K6MA. He's got an antenna growing out of his head. And there's our friend Mort, NA6MA. He passed away this year, right before Baker to Vegas. Silent key now. And anyways, that's kind of what we do. There's Clara holding up the moon, and there's Mort holding up the moon. Gwenny again. And there's N6AA. There's Dick Norton. He's our Southwestern Division manager. I don't remember exactly what his title is. But I did a show about him from the Yuma Ham Fest. Anyhow, lots of fun pictures here. We had a lot of fun. This one's one of my favorites. Again, Bernard really knows how to get that smile going. So, back to my ham radio story. We kind of started there, and I got licensed and I got involved and just started doing lots of stuff like field day, stuff like Baker to Vegas. The first Gwenny's thing was field day.
Yep.
And pretty much didn't. I don't think you missed hardly any field days. You were at camp 1 year. And then my son Ian, his thing was Faker to Vegas, and that was Ian in...
they can't see it.
Oh, yeah. That's why I need a sidekick. That's Ian in 2012 on the way to go to Baker to Vegas. And there's some of the other teams. There's Mortigan. Again, he's Silent Key. We stopped at the Flying J in Barstow, one of the awesome spots. There's Scott WA9er STI. And there's the Caravan. And we stopped at Goldstone Deep Space Communications Complex. It's really cool. There was lots of these huge, giant radio telescopes. And we got to go inside and like stand underneath these huge dishes. And that was fun. It was very cool. And then we actually went to the race a little later on. And again, here's Ian at... Stage 9, and we've been working Stage 9. I think that's my first year, 2012. So that would mean 6 years. Is that 6 years? We've been doing that. A lot of fun. And let's see what else is in here. Pictures-wise, anything else? Major exciting. There's us working at night. Is that... Nope, that's not me. It's somebody else. I mean, not a ton of pictures that year. There's some handoffs. That's what it looks like in the dark when we're there. Lots of peace officers passing the baton and running around having fun. So, yeah, pretty much starting then. I think if I look here at 2011, was before I was licensed. Or that was, I guess that was the first year I was licensed, but I don't think I went that year. That was before. The Goldstone one was the first time that I made it out there. But that's the old crew. And, it was a lot of fun. That was a great thing to do. And, you know, and then we went on to do lots of stuff amateur radio-wise. I've done almost all the Baker to Vegas's. There's 1 year I did have to miss. AC100 is Angeles Crest 100. It's an ultra-marathon. About 250 runners run 100 miles in about 25 hours is about their best time. And... they do it through the mountains of Southern California. It's a pretty grueling course. Lots of other stuff we do in our organization, and you know, amateur radio has meant a lot to me. I started off back in those days. I had the mini van. I had a Mazda 5 with a Wuxian HT strapped to the dash on a little holder. And a Magmana antenna outside and a hand mic. And I ran that radio for a long, long time until I killed that car in an accident. And then since then, I upgraded to the FJ. Mom's car never had any radios, nope. Only temporarily. But she does have a license, although I don't think
she's ever talked on the radio.
Yeah, I don't think she has ever either. But yeah. And... let's see, our house, just to give you a little more information, we're a multi-generational house. My parents live right up there over my garage. I'm in my garage over the studio. My dad's a ham. He got his ticket shortly after I did, and he's done stuff. He's
B2V.
Yep, he's done B2V. AC100 is too hard for him. He didn't like to be out overnight. But he's done a lot of the other hospital drills and whatever. His... call 6 is very similar to Gwen's call sign. It's November 6, Mike Golf. And we've done a lot of stuff. He's starting to slow down a little bit, not doing as much stuff anymore, taking care of my mom more. He was the second one in the house to get his ticket. And then Mom beat you guys.
Yeah.
Mom beat you guys, and she did it. I think she did it to... make me happy.
No, she did it because there was an earthquake.
Oh, yeah.
And then she's like, I need to have something to like contact you if there's an earthquake and I can't use the phone or that kind of stuff.
Yeah, right, so. Right. Yeah, that's right. There was an earthquake. She was in the shower, I think, or mm-hmm. I was, something like that.
No, she was in the shower.
And then you guys started doing stuff with us but didn't get your licenses. I think Ian tried once and he didn't pass the first time. And then about a year and a half ago, you guys went with to one of the classes that our Aries group did. And both you and Ian on the same day, you guys both passed.
Yep.
Did you do better than he did?
I got only one question wrong. Yeah. So probably.
Yeah, I think you did better than he did. And his mom's the only one that got the perfect score. Mm-hmm. And of course she never uses radio, but that's okay. and then Lila, who's my third, she got her license just earlier this year, in preparation for her wanting to come with us. And she did to, Baker to Vegas, this go around, and have some pictures here. I should show you guys some pictures of that. It is a family affair.
Yes.
And, let's see. So, if I can find a good one. There's Lila eating a cloud. It's not a great one, but that's what it is. And yeah, come on. There's ice cream. Bernard loves to bring ice cream too. Bernard buys the dry ice and brings it out there to the desert. So you could actually drive nails into the wall with those ice cream cones when he has some tea. You gotta let him warm up a little bit. So there's Gwen working the mile out station.
It was cold.
And that's Lila. She's Whiskey Zero Lima Romeo Golf. And there's Gwen and her ice cream. There's some runners. Of course, it's all about my family, not so much about the race. There's a good one. That's Chuck Foote. He's the, I think that's Chuck. He's one of the race officials. That's not Chuck, that's the other guy, John, but I can't be 100% sure because I only think I met him that one time. And somewhere, is there a picture of Ian in there? Oh, no, that's Chuck Foote. He's the race organizer. He came out and visited us.
We're special.
And we were special. And this was my first year, myself and Dennis, KJ6GVQ, we got promoted this year to be stage leads for Stage 9. We'd been working it for a number of years, but Ruzy, who'd been running it, got called into the Medical Radio Network, and he had to handle that. So we ran it. I think we did okay. I don't see any pictures of your brother in here.
He was cooking the whole time.
Yeah, he was cooking. Oh, he's in here. He's holding the camera. Nope.
That's his butt.
Isn't that lovely? Let's see. We'll see if we can get better than a picture of his butt. You said butt. Nope. Okay, we're going to go back to... that's on the way to the race. But that still didn't have Ian in it. I think Ian sat in the car while we bought the t-shirts.
Yeah.
Oh, there he is. There he is. That's Ian. Our Eagle Scout. Our first Eagle Scout. We're going to have some more in the house soon. So I think that was the latest big all family thing that we did amateur radio wise. We did you and Ian came along to that last hospital drill that I did film of. I still have the film on the PC here, and I got to put together. We did a we do a lot of these things where we do drills at hospitals. We did a simulated bus versus truck crash outside the hospital, and they did a full on 20 or so people and moulage, and they brought out the tarps and they put everybody on the green, yellow, red, or black tarp, depending on what happened. And then they triaged them and treated them and brought them into the hospital. It was kind of fun. It was interesting. It was good experience for a lot of the new hams. It wasn't fun?
It wasn't fun because I didn't have any injuries.
Oh, yeah. Gwen wasn't injured, and they didn't let her play amateur radio because she was getting service hours for ROTC. Yeah, absolutely. So I see there's some folks in the chat room. Oh, David, KK6DA. How are you doing? There's actually a question here from Brian. Brian asks, how does your Aries Races group stay involved with the county? Fresno County is super slow in recognizing Aries member and getting them carded for races. Well, you know, that is a good question. So I have zero knowledge in Los Angeles City or County of races at all. I have no idea. I think that they're here, but I don't know who's part of the group and or how they function or what they do. Really, I'm primary Aries. I actually did eventually join the LA County DCS, but I'm primary Aries, and mostly the way we stay involved and the way we get involved with our city and county I would say is probably 90%+ are DEC, Rusy Mowberry, W1EH. Here's a picture of the Supreme Commander, as we like to call him. Let's see. There he is. Oh, that's Rusy. Rusy is just super awesome at forming relationships and knocking on doors. And he's in the communications business. He works for a commercial radio service. And so he has opportunities to go and see all these people. He works on the fire truck radios, more of the repeaters and stuff like that, not the actual radios. And with hospitals and with other organizations. And, he just is really great at spending the time forming the relationships. We have great relationships with folks from the California Highway Patrol, from the Los Angeles Fire Department, Los Angeles Police Department. We've done drills with the California National Guard. That was fun. You did that.
I've done it twice. Yeah.
Where we do a disaster drill with them, and we actually, Gwen and my role for the past couple of years is kind of being the tour guide for the National Guard. They have an armory here, and they activate for 1 weekend a month and 2 weeks a year. And on one of their weekends a month, we'll do a drill or stage some kind of exercise. And because I have a four-wheel drive truck, we take them up to one of the dirt roads and one of the hilltops that overlook both the city and the valley at the same time. And we set up comms, and they set up comms as well, and see if everybody can talk to everybody. We did that. You did that twice, I think.
I've done it twice,
yeah. And I've done it four or five times. That's actually really fun, fun event, because you get to go in the armory and see how the guard works and how all their folks function together. This last year, we actually got to sit at the, they call it the TOC. The TOC is the Tactical Action Center, something like that. That's where basically where all of the big action goes on. And I'm trying to find the picture before I put it up. I'm going to just talk a little bit. That's where all the big major action goes on. And at the table there at the talk where we were, there were representatives from the California National Guard Command was there, LAPD Command. There were two captains, I think, or three captains there. There was the California Highway Patrol Command, the LA Fire Department Command, and we basically sat there at the tabletop part of the exercise and participated with them doing injects and passing traffic and messages back and forth. They had a live exercise at one of the local hospitals where they moulanged a bunch of ROTC kids and some of my Boy Scout troop. And they ran them through the drill. That was really cool. And towards the end of the tabletop exercise was when Gwen and I hopped in the truck and we drove up to the top of the hill. There's an old retired Nike base where they used to have the Nike missiles, and we went up there and they tried to test their radios, and we did run our radios. And that was cool. But again, back to the question, In LA, it's really about the relationship. It's about finding out the right people in the right areas and making relationships. I have some other friends. N4BMP, Nathan, is really good at working with our NGOs and our elected representatives, and has put together a number of programs with amateur radio and disaster supplies and relief. And he's allowed us to make a bunch of really great relationships and contacts there as well. And I think, if you're looking for, ways to get involved and make that involvement with the first responders, and I think that's probably kind of where your question goes. I know when I first started in the beginning, it was difficult and frustrating because I don't think our organization or any of the organizations really had great relationships, and we weren't always treated seriously by the first responders. And it's taken a lot of time, a lot of years. But again, I really credit Rusy for having made that happen. He's been really great at that. And otherwise, just, show up and help. And at some point they realize that that you have value.
As long as you're not that guy that shows up, you know, in the belt and suspenders with six Baofeng radios and, you know, declare that you're here to save the day and be in charge. I think that if you just, you know, show up and ask how you can help and stay out of the way and provide some value, that over time the professionals will realize that there are times where they need you, and that's helpful.
I have a question.
You have a question?
What are other examples that you like use ham radio, or you like participate in ham radio events outside of like Aries?
What do I do outside? Well, so other than well, that's a good point. So other than Aries and my participation with Aries, again, I did join DCS. I do a little bit of stuff with them, but not so much. Mostly I hope when I join there, I could help do some interoperability, some liaisoning between the two organizations. And I think we're getting there. We're starting to do some NBeams nets. And then there's Boy Scouts. And I sometimes forget about when I'm sitting here in the chair, although we've done a number of Boy Scout episodes. I'm very involved in the Boy Scouts as a volunteer. And I've done 3 or 4 years of Jamboree on the Air, as well as just, you know, being a scout leader. And that's another interesting kind of start story. When I first joined, when Ian was 10 and a half and went on his first Boy Scout trip, and I probably told the story over the air on the show in the past before, but we'll go through it again. What the heck? When he first started off, he wasn't 11 yet. You have to be 11 to join. And so because of that, he had to have a parent come along. And, you know, actually loved and used to backpack all the time. So it was a great opportunity for me to say, let's go. Let's have some fun. And I was already licensed at the time. And so I went along. And like always, pretty much everywhere I go, I bring an HT, bring a ham radio with me. And I did, and I noticed that they were all using FRS radios, so there wasn't much to do, and didn't really know them all that well, but I thought I'd just listen and monitor. And it was a long, long, long backpacking trip. We called it the Baton Death March. I think it was, it's a trail or a hike to a place called Fishbowls up here in the Gorman area. It's about 7 miles in and about 7 miles out, and you do it a day in and a day out. It's mostly flat, a little bit of hills, but for 10 and a half year old, 11, 12, 13 year old boys that haven't done a lot of backpacking and haven't been used to carrying a lot of stuff, it's a long day. It's a long hike. And over time or on the trail, there were some more experienced boys, and they got kind of spread out and spread out and spread out. And, you know, those FRS radios are only good so far. I know if you look at the package, it says good for 30 miles or whatever, but, you know, that's mountaintop to mountaintop. And so at one point it became clear that they were having a problem, and to me it constituted an emergency. And so I thought, well, if it's an emergency, then anything goes, and I can change my radio from just listen mode on the FRS frequencies to talk. And I hopped in there and told them that I could hear both the front of the line and the end of the line, and that the end of the line was having a problem and the front of the line needed to stop and come back and help out. And had a lot of questions from the troop folks after that, and when we got into camp, and everybody was really interested in amateur radio and could everybody do that. And I told them, oh yeah, if we get a license, we'll all talk in the amateur frequencies and we could talk legally and longer and farther. And within a short time, probably in a matter of maybe a year and a half or 2 years, there were 6 licensed adults, and I think now there's probably about a dozen that are active with the troop that have their license, as well as a number of the scouts as well. And and that's been great. It's been super for the troop. They really enjoy it. They really like it. And I think that it's a good thing. I think scouting embraces amateur radio. I do amateur radio merit badge. I'll teach that once or twice a year, in addition to doing the Jamboree on the Air. And then again, like I said, where's my HT? It was here before. I carry this thing around pretty much wherever I go. A lot of times it's just in my backpack or my messenger bag. Like I don't, you know, carry it around all the halls at work.
Carry it at the grocery store.
Yeah, I guess I don't carry it at the grocery store. Because my work job doesn't really entail me needing to have a radio. But it does start up a lot of conversations. I do talk to a lot of people about it and get people interested. And, you know, over the years, I send a lot of people to my old Elmers, Norma, Naomi. They probably license over 120, 150 people every year, year in and year out. And or send them the classes that we do. We don't do them quite as frequently, but we do them. And, you know, as folks say here, Paul's talking about, you know, parades and bike races. And, you know, we do those too. I know a lot of the folks in the, in our organization, in the area's organizations will work, the LA Marathon. They'll work bike races, DCS, the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Group. They work a lot of, stuff in Malibu. They kind of cover that area. So lots of, bike races and triathlons and whatever occur up there. And so they do a lot of crowd control and traffic control for that. We do drills. You know, we work with the hospitals primarily. That's our MOU in Los Angeles County. We work with 66 hospitals throughout the county. And, you know, I have a couple of them that are assigned to me and a bunch of volunteers. And that's a great relationship when, when they're, interested in using us, it works really well. Sometimes not so much. And then they realize when they get to a certain part of the year, that they need to have us participate in their yearly drills. So usually it's a quick call to us and they panic to say, hey, can you come and help us? Are you going to be able to do that? I don't know if you've done any of those hospital drills with us. I know you've done National Guard. And
I did the one at the Madrid Theater.
Yeah, oh yeah, that was a cert drill. The Madrid Theater is a great picture of me and my two girls, and they're all bloodied and battered, but it's all menage. And that was fun for them. So that's kind of it. That's kind of how I got there. Hi, Gary. Gary Pierce is in the room. He's not with us, but he's watching. That's great. And so that's how we got there. So Gwen, tell me your ham radio story. How'd you get here?
I got here because I started like participating like with field day, like Dad said. And then I got kind of jealous after Ian had gone to B2V with Dad, like after seeing like what they did. So I was like, sign me up, I'm coming with you next time. So then it came to that. And then like sprinkled throughout, there's been like drills, like the one with the California Guard and the one at the Madrid Theater with Lila. And then more recently, I've started doing the AC100 races, which is also like, it's like a different sort of drill, but it's also fun to work.
Yeah. So what is that? What is that AC100 thing?
So at AC100, the way that like we work it is like the logging is all done like on the computer as opposed to like writing the numbers out.
Mm-hmm. Do you know what that's called?
FL Digi?
No. That's packet.
Oh.
And we use a 220 packet for that. It's okay.
Yeah. I don't know what else.
What else? You have done other stuff.
I've gone to meetings.
Yeah. Okay.
I don't know.
Sounds good.
Yeah.
And they treat you like a real ham now, don't they? Mostly.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
Looking to see if I can't find a picture or two from, here you go. All right. That's the cert drill. Like I said, bruised and bloody. That was 2014. And, I was working Aries and the girls were victims. So they let them moulange them up and, they participated as volunteers. And that was kind of fun drill. That was great. I got to follow some of the cert folks inside and almost every one of them touched a piece of metal and died from electrocution or had some kind of other problem along the way. So I think with that, we've been rambling on for about 40 minutes and just wanted to put some stuff up there and I wanted to say hello to everybody. And I was hoping that there'd be some folks out there to watch us and there are. And again, I got some, actually have somebody lined up for next Tuesday. And I hope that that will be a great episode. I hope that she works out. And I'm working on some other stuff. Last month was real busy with work, but summertime I'm going to have some time. And I got a new co-host here. If she works out, we'll have her on. And maybe we can enjoy her learning more about amateur radio. She's been doing it for a while, but have some stuff to learn. I gave her the general class book. You got it? Well, you got the ham study, the ham study application. So some of the kids were talking about trying to upgrade this summer. Well, I guess with that, I do have to go pick up my other daughter. So before I go, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by us, but it's also brought to you by you. So can't do it without your help. And I know I haven't provided a lot of content to justify putting my hand out and asking you to feed the pig. But if you enjoy what we're doing, I will keep all of the content up there. I know Gary spent a lot of years putting all that stuff together. Shake him. There's money in there. Putting all this content together. And although he's stepped aside to do his new great show, part of the legacy of Ham Radio Now and part of why I want to keep it going is to keep all that great media out there. So even if I don't have a new show, there's almost 400 in the back catalog. If you're really jonesing for something, take a look at one of the old shows, some of the old stuff that Gary did, some of the old stuff that we did. I've been around for a while now, a couple of years at least. And again, thanks for watching. So I think with that, I'm going to let Gwen introduce herself. Again?
Introduce myself.
Well, or say goodbye.
Bye. I'm Gwen. bye.
Bye. Is that it? Who are you?
Gwen Goldenberg, N6GMG.
Okay. And I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG. And you had to end a show?
No.
Come on.
You put your hand on it?
No. Really?
No, I like how you end it.
How we end the show. I almost think I'm going to bring Gary in to call Gary real quick and have him end the show.
I don't know.
I'm gonna start it and you might get the last word. And if not, I'm just going to pick it up. This was Ham Radio Now, episode number 398. Guess who's back? Thanks for watching. Over and...
out!
Awesome.
Hey, I got it.
You did. You totally got it. Was that loud?
When I screamed it.
Yeah. Cool. All right.